turn. Now let's stand up and shake each other's hands. Amen. Now that you got seated. I would encourage you to turn to 2 Timothy chapter number 4. 2 Timothy chapter number 4. Right. Well, I've been doing some reading this week and trying to help you as much as I can, because I know how much some of you need help when it comes to New Year's resolutions. And so I found an article that lists 15 New Year's resolutions. I'm not sure exactly when the survey was taken. I think it was either 2015 or 2016, but it was from high school kids, teenagers, on up through adults. And so here are 15 suggested New Year's resolutions to help you. Number one, and these are in no particular order, become stress-free. Now that's a big order, amen. Resolve yourself to let some things that just weigh you down and worry you, get rid of them. You know what? Lay those at the feet of Jesus. God has a plan for your life. Not every day is going to be rosy. Not every day is going to be peachy. Not every day is going to have the result that you want it to have. There's going to be situations, but I'm telling you, don't stress out over everything. You let the Lord be the Lord, and He'll take care of you. Amen? Number two, lose weight. You don't have to do all of these. Number three, quit smoking. Number four, increase education. Number five, save money. Number six, get healthier. Number seven, get good grades. Number eight, learn a new language. Number nine, stop watching so much television. Number 10, start reading more books. Number 11, get more sleep. Number 12, volunteer in your community. Number 13, organize your life. Number 14, be more outgoing. And number 15, don't make New Year's resolutions. Now you choose one of those or some of those, and we'll see what happens. Amen. I'm going to make one New Year's resolution. I'm going to make two. One I'll explain to you later. But one for sure, I'm going to eat more taters. I think that's a resolution that I can keep all year long. I'm going to eat more taters. I'm going to eat my taters with onions. I'm going to eat my taters with peppers. I might even eat my potatoes with some ground beef in them. Hey, that's pretty doggone good. You put a little taco seasoning mix on there, mix some taters in, instant homemade hamburger helper. Put a little cheese on them, whatever you do. Let's just say, let's eat more taters. How many would like to make a resolution to eat more taters this year? Amen? Amen. That's some of us. We'll eat more taters. Lordy Bert, somebody will be bringing taters for every fellowship meal we got now, won't we? We'll be having an abundance of potatoes. Amen. Let me pause just a minute. Amen and good morning. Good to have you this morning. If you have your Bibles, in 2 Timothy chapter number 2 is where we're going to find our text this morning. Chapter number 4. We know that Timothy was like a son to Paul. We know, as we have learned, that Timothy had the opportunity to lead Timothy to the Lord, as we would say, to see Timothy surrender his life and be saved through Jesus Christ. And so we know, most of our students of Scripture know the relationship between Paul and Timothy, who was probably in his early 20s, more than likely around that age. Wish I was 20 again, amen. And so Timothy is receiving this letter, and from the tone of this letter, it seems that Paul felt like his days on this earth may be coming to an end. None of us know when our last day on this earth is going to be. We need to make the most of every day and live every day for Jesus, and then we'll just be fine. Amen. And so we find this morning that Timothy is receiving this letter from the hand and the pen of the Apostle Paul. And in verse number 1, we find that Paul is challenging Timothy, or he is charging Timothy. He says, "I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and at his kingdom." He says to Timothy, "Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears." In other words, in the latter days, congregations, groups of people will want men to stand before them that sugarcoats everything and stays away from the preachings of the truth and gives a message of, we're all good, God is making us all better, and things are all great, and if you just name it, you can claim it, and all is good. I believe we're in those latter days. Somebody say amen. But Paul says, "Now, Timothy, you hear me. They shall turn away their ears from the truth, and they shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things." He says, "Timothy, you endure afflictions. Now, Timothy, you do the work of an evangelist. Now, Timothy, you make full proof of thy ministry." And let us pray. Father, I thank you again for the opportunity to stand this morning and pray, Lord Jesus, for your anointing continually. And may we receive that which you would say into our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. I really don't know what kind of New Year's resolutions you make, or if you make them at all. There are some changes I'd like to make in my life, but I like to daily resolve to do those things. Amen. I know that there are so many areas in my life that I could improve in the sight of God. My wife could probably make you a 3-page list of ways that I could improve, around the house. Please don't give her 3 pages to write on, okay? But all of us, we agree that we would like to see some things different in our life. Amen. We'd like to see some situations change, and we think about the new year as an opportunity of change, new beginnings, when we see things like that. And it's traditional for us in the Western culture to think about things we'd like to do different. The tradition of making New Year's resolution is really something that is customary to the Western culture as opposed to the East, but that's just a part of our celebrations. But I want to really share with you this morning, there is a New Year's resolution that every one of us should make, and that is We should be more evangelistic. We ought to be more evangelistic. Resolve ourselves to pray for, see, and seize opportunities to share the good news of Jesus and to be evangelistic. Evangelism speaks of obeying the Great Commission. As the Gospel of Matthew closes with the words of Jesus, "Go you into all the nations, teaching them to observe the things that I've taught, baptizing them, equipping them." It's the Great Commission. So evangelism speaks of our obedience in doing what Jesus asked us to do. Evangelism speaks of snatching sinners from hell and sharing with them a hope of eternity. Amen? Snatching them from hell. When we share the good news and we share with them that there is an eternity of hope, we are in essence becoming a lifeline as God uses us to reach them with the message that there is hope. And so evangelism speaks of growing churches, amen? When sinners get saved, they need to be discipled. I believe that when we lead people to Jesus, we need to encourage them to make a church attendance a part of their life so that they can grow and come to understand what the Bible teaches. And so evangelism is not easy, amen? Evangelism demands work. It's not easy for us to accomplish the things that we set out to accomplish. It's not easy for us always to keep our resolutions. But I believe that with God's help, seeing that it is God's desire that every one of us can become more evangelistic in our individual lives in 2017 than we were in 2016. And if you believe that, say amen. Evangelism demands work. I might ask you, how should evangelism involve every member of the church? I could ask you, how does evangelism call for ending spectator Christianity? I might ask you, how can we do the work of evangelism? I believe the answer is found in Scripture. And I believe the answer is found in the potato patch. First of all, I would read to you 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, verse 3 and 4. Paul says, "I delivered unto you that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He arose again the third day according to Scripture." If there was one evangelistic scripture that I would have you to remember outside of John 3:16, it would be this very passage. Because this passage in 1 Corinthians shares four vital truths that I believe everyone needs to come to understand. First of all, it tells us that Christ died for our sins. We need to understand what His substitutionary, His propitiatory sacrifice really was. In other words, He became sin that we could become saved. Amen. He took the sin of the world and He put it on His sinless shoulders, and He allowed Himself to be crucified, taking the punishment that every sinner deserves. Second of all, that passage tells us that He was buried. He was buried, which is evidence of the reality of the totality of His death. I'm going to throw some of them 50 cent words at you. Amen. In other words, He was graveyard dead. Understand, He didn't go into a coma. He didn't go into some sleep. They didn't give Him some drug when they gave Him vinegar and water on the sponge to knock Him out. I'm telling you, He was graveyard dead. He breathed His last breath from a human body and He died. It also tells us that He was buried and that He rose again. Amen. They say you can't keep a good man down. I might question that, But I'll tell you this, they could not put the good Lord Jesus down. He rose again, amen. All the forces of hell could not keep him down. All the forces of hell could not retain him. He overcame and he rose again. He raised in the past and he remains alive now. And he will remain alive forever and ever and ever. Amen. And all of this was according to Scripture. In other words, it all occurred as it was predicted. Oh my, we have a truth to share, and we ought to set ourselves to be more evangelistic in this year, and we ought to tell folks the truth because the world needs to hear the truth. And so point number one, let's preach the gospel. Say that with me. Amen. Now listen, this is the potato patch that I was referring to. I'm going to eat more potatoes. There's all kinds of potatoes. I like these nice, big, just regular old russet bacon potatoes. Amen. But when it comes to the church, and I think about potatoes, I think about the fact and the terminology of a couch potato. How many of you know what a couch potato is? So come on, raise your hand. How many know what a couch potato is? Listen, son, Don, if you're not getting the hint, I think your wife is saying that you're a couch potato. And I bet that what she's trying to tell you is that you've been sitting around a whole lot and that you need to get off there, your keister, and get off that couch and get out there and be more active. Now, I'm just trying to read her mind. I'm saying that she's calling you a couch potato because she's probably got a list of 15 things that she'd like for you to do and you don't want to get off the couch and do them. She's probably got about 10 places that she'd like for you to take her to eat and take her to enjoy the sights, and you just won't get off the couch and do it. Now, listen, am I getting close, sister? Huh? Now, boy, I started a feud in that house, didn't I? But the problem is, I think that in the church, there are too many foes that are just couch potatoes. They come to church and they take their place, and amen, we need pew potatoes. We sure do. We need to have an abundance, a crop of potatoes, and we need to have a potato in every chair, amen. There needs to be some taters in the church, amen. But we don't need to be the kind that just come and sit around. We need to be the kind of potatoes. We need to be the kind of people that come to church and get involved. And the greatest area that we can get involved in is evangelism, amen. And that means getting up off of your sofa and going out and knocking on doors from time to time and handing out some tracts and handing out some invitations for church and inviting them to church and giving them a light bulb or giving them a loaf of bread or giving them something or just give them a tater and say, hey, I just want to tell you about Jesus. Somebody say amen. Lana, think fast. And so this morning, we need to understand how important it is that we are more than just couch potatoes. We need to understand that there are some things that each and every one of us need to be doing. And most importantly, it is to preach the gospel. There is nothing better than the gospel. Amen. The gospel is better than social action. I love social activities. I like to do things with groups of people. I like to do things with crowds of people. But I want you to know that sharing the gospel is better than social action. Did you know that sharing the gospel is better than political involvement? And I know some of you have been politically involved, and I say amen, and I applaud that, and I say thank God, because we as Christians need to be politically involved, and we need to spread the message that there is hope, and we need politicians that aren't ashamed to stand up and say, I love Jesus, Jesus loves me, and only God can help us in this world. Amen. But listen to me, sharing evangelism, sharing the gospel is better than religious ritual. Now, we do some things around here that have just really become rituals, you know what I mean? Hey, eating once a month together, that's kind of like a ritual, but it's a good ritual. Y'all say amen. Huh? Yeah, I mean, we've got some things that we do every now and then that are good. But I'm telling you what, it doesn't matter what the religious ritual is. Of most importance is evangelism. I'm telling you, sharing the gospel is better than watching the college football playoffs. Say amen. Hey, listen, sharing the gospel is better than watching the Cardinals and the Royals in the World Series. Amen. Sharing the gospel is better than holding that grandchild you love and spoiling that grandchild. You know what you need to do for that grandchild? Share the gospel with them. Amen. Listen to me. First of all, let's just make it sure that we become more than couch potatoes, that we get out in our communities, that we get in our families, and we get involved in sharing the gospel. If you're with me, say amen. You see, we've got to preach by our lives and our lips. We got to preach from the pulpit. We got to preach from the places of work. We got to preach from the places where we gather for fun. We've got to preach by our witness. We got to preach by our walk. We've got to be involved and get off the pew and get off the couch and make sure that in 2017 we're willing to share the gospel with somebody that needs to hear it. Say amen. Second of all, let's plead with sinners. Let's present the gospel, yes. But I'm telling you what, sometimes that's not enough. Sometimes we want to hold on to this one and done. Well, I shared it with them once. That's all I'm obligated to share with them. By the way, evangelism is an obligation. I'm telling you right now. It's the greatest opportunity to have, but it is an obligation. But when I say let's plead with sinners, what I mean is let's not only share the gospel, but let's continually share the gospel. Amen? Let's be concerned about sinners. Let's show them some love. Amen? Let's just be sweet taters. Amen? Let's just go out there and be kind to sinners. And those that do you wrong, do good unto them. And those that despise you, you share love with them. And those that would not give you the time of day, you smile when you can, and you greet them with a kind word, and you be a sweet potato, amen? And in 2017, why don't you try to be a sweet potato and bury the hatchet with somebody that might be your enemy? In 2017, why don't you try to be a sweet potato and try to reconcile some differences with some family members? In 2017, why don't you be a sweet potato, amen, and go out and show kindness like you never have before, amen? And in 2017, why don't you find a way to brighten somebody's day? And in 2017, why don't you be sweeter and stop judging people? And in 2017, why don't you just go out there and let them know that they can know peace, hope, and joy, and love. And it's all because of what Jesus done for us. Amen. Let's be some sweet taters. Amen. Think fast, Larry. Amen. What does it mean? Plead with sinners. Be a sweet potato. Let them know we care. I mean, sometimes it's almost as if we've forgotten that sinners go to hell. Huh? I mean, memory loss affects all of us. Amen? It sure does. But sometimes it's almost as if we as saints have forgotten that people that die without Jesus go to hell. And that ought to disturb us. That ought to shock us. You hear me? That ought to be motive enough for us to get out there and plead with sinners and let them know that we care. Peter wrote, "The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." They need to know that God is love. The cross says God cares about sinners going to hell. And this urgent message must have priority in our lives again. So let's stop being couch potatoes. Let's be sweet potatoes and find a way to befriend people and show them the love of God. Amen. Amen. Let's preach the gospel. Let's plead with sinners. And let's perfect the saints. Ephesians 4 and 12. Evangelists, pastors, teachers, be given for the perfecting the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Let's perfect the saints. Last night, I had a bowl of potato soup. And I'm going to tell you, I don't know. I think it was an old family recipe. But I want you to know, whatever was in that potato soup, them ingredients were mixed absolutely perfectly. And I love my wife, and she knows that I love my wife. But baby doll, you need to take some lessons, because that was some good potato soup. I will tell you something. You know what makes a good church? When we realize that we are all a part of God's plan, and we are all an ingredient in His soup, amen? And we all have different gifts, okay? And we all have different talents, amen? We all have different strengths, amen? We all have different likenesses, things that we like to do, the gifts of hospitality, the gifts of charity. We're all different. But you know what? God takes each and every one of us where we are. When we just surrender ourselves to Him, He takes every one of us and He mixes us together, amen? And then what really makes it good is the main ingredient is not us as potatoes, but it's when that Holy Spirit gets in us, hey, and this starts working in us and starts simmering in us, amen? And then when we blend all the way together, hey, I'm telling you what, we'll make the perfect soup. Say everybody, say amen. Ain't that cool? You know what? It takes more than me standing here preaching on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights. It does. It takes more than our Sunday school teachers teaching Sunday school on Sunday morning. It does. Hey, it takes more than you giving your tithes and your offerings. It does. All of those are important. It takes more than just those that work with our children on Wednesday night. But when you take all of that and you blend all of that together, hey, listen, and you let it simmer before God and the Holy Spirit being the main ingredient and seasoning us and seasoning in our speech and seasoning in our thoughts and seasoning in our life, I want you to know we, Abounding Hope, and wherever you go to church, we, the family of God, can be something special, amen. So that when the world of sinners gets a taste of us, they want to come back for more. Amen? Yes. I'm telling you, folks, we just need to perfect the saints. In other words, we need to be trained. We need to equip the rank and file of Christian soldiers because the battle is at hand. And we need strength for the battle. And we need nourishment for the battles. Let the saints be perfected by pastors and teachers and evangelists. Why perfect the saints? Obviously, as he said, to do the work of the ministry. Because all of us need to be involved in the ministry of this church. WMU, whatever. We all need to be involved in the ministry of this church. We need to motivate one another to go out and win souls. We need to equip folks to disciple new converts, to build up the church spiritually. And when we set our minds on evangelism and we go out and we, according to God's will, as God's Spirit leads us in obedience, then I believe that we can grow the church, not only spiritually, but numerically. And that's a good goal, amen? To grow to spiritual maturity. And finally, let's pull the net together. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Well, let's preach the gospel. Let's share our testimonies. Let's plead with sinners. Let's show them that we do have a love and a compassion for their soul. Let's perfect the saints. Let's learn from one another. Let's get involved in the ministry of the church. And then all together, let's pull the nets. You know, all believers are to be fishers of men. Matthew 4:19 tells us so. And fishermen, when you go fishing, you surely expect to catch fish. I guess people have done it before. I have never went to a river, a lake, or a pond and threw an empty hook out and just let it set in the water. Huh? Because what good is that? I put something on that hook, or I throw something colorful, something that spins and something that sparkles and something that attracts those fish, because I expect to catch some fish. Amen. Amen. We must give the opportunity to people to accept Christ and get them to the point where you say, do you feel like this is something that you need to do? Let me pray with you. You see, the problem in the church is we've got a lot of couch potatoes that don't want to do anything. There's not enough sweet potatoes. And we want to be lone rangers, and we don't want to be an ingredient to work together as God's family and God's team. We need to, in 2017, end this plague of spectators. Yeah, you ever grown one like this, Jim? Huh? You're a spectator. Now, these are beautifully, professionally drawn specs on this potato. Did that myself. We'll auction this off after church on the assignment. And then let God hold on to this, and it'll be worth a lot someday. The truth of the matter is, the longer you keep this potato, as long as this potato is just sitting around and not fulfilling its purpose, you'll see little spots develop on it. You'll see a little rotten spot here, and you'll see a little spoiled spot there. And you know what, Sister Sandy? That's what happens with spectator Christian. They just dry up on God. Because their lack of involvement, their carefree existence, it doesn't strengthen them. It doesn't increase their hope. It doesn't excite them. It's when you get out and you work for God and you try to make a difference and you become involved in people's lives, you become involved in the church, that's when you really get a zeal in your life. And that's really what motivates you to get closer to Christ. You see, when you take, I've heard it said, when you take an inch towards God, He'll draw a foot towards you. And I don't know where you go to church, and I know y'all go to church. You're here this morning, amen. So something is important to you about Christianity. Something is important to you about church. But Abounding Hope, we need to make
this a congregation that is involved in every ministry opportunity God gives us, and we need to make a priority, and we need to resolve ourselves to be more evangelistic and to be more creative and to be more Christ-like and to get out there and let's win some souls for Jesus in 2017. Amen.
And I believe with all of my heart that if we work together, we can pull the net. We cast the net. We tell folks about Jesus. We tell folks about the church. And we are all pulling together. We've got to pull the net carefully. We've got to pull the net prayerfully. We've got to pull the net as we're led by the Holy Spirit. And we've got to pull the net repeatedly and expectedly, believing that we are going to see souls come to know Jesus by lovingly, passionately teaching the truth. God can reward our evangelistic efforts. Let's put an end to spectator Christianity in 2017. Amen. And I believe if we'll resolve ourselves to do that, we'll be able to lead somebody to Jesus. Father, in your name, I am so thankful for the opportunity, Lord, that you've given me this morning. And I just pray, Lord, that something that's been said this morning, Jesus, will be used by you to charge us up, encourage us, to challenge us. If there be one here that's lost, then I pray that this would be the day that they would come to know you as Lord and Savior. Lord, I've shared the gospel and the message. It's all about trust in you, what you've done for us. And so if there be one here that's lost, I pray that on this day, they would understand that you're giving them an opportunity to find salvation, to find hope. I pray, Lord Jesus, that we would indeed be challenged to be more involved in this church and in the work and ministry that you've called us into. Lord Jesus, thank you for the glorious opportunity to have lived another year and to look forward to what you can do through us and with us in the coming year. May we see growth spiritually, numerically, for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, by way of invitation, if you need Jesus, if you're not sure that you would go to heaven if you were to die today, please let me open my Bible. Let me share with you how you can become a Christian. Let me challenge you in these closing moments. Come to the altar. We pray that the Lord would give you a heart for evangelism. Come to the altar and pray that the Lord would give you a heart for ministry. Come to the altar and pray that the Lord would give you a heart for souls that are lost and on their way to heaven. And that's the invitation this morning.